We want to welcome you to another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church of Greenville, Ohio. First Presbyterian is located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached by phone at 937-548-3188. We hope as a result of this service that you will find that our message is uplifting and meaningful to help you in your daily walk in spiritual life as a Christian. Throughout the week, we have several ministries that I know will be of help to you. Wednesdays in particular, there are several Bible studies for both adults as well as children. Our Logos ministry is for children preschool through fifth grade. We have JAM, Jesus and Me, for junior highs, and then our senior high ministry Wednesday evening. If you do not have a church home, we invite you to participate and be involved in our worshiping community, whether on the airwaves or certainly personally in the congregation. At this time, we'd like to invite you to be part of our family of faith here at First Presbyterian as we worship the Lord and listen to God's living word.
Everything I am, everything I'm not, I'm yours. was, Lord. Try me now and see. See if I could be completely yours. You put in us all desire to belong, to join with your strength and thus become strong. With that thought in mind, I reach for the prize. I lift up my voice to re-emphasize that I'm yours, Lord. Everything I've got, everything I am, everything I'm not, I'm yours, Lord. Try me now and see. See if I could be completely yours.
Lord, as we come into your presence this morning, we come with grateful hearts for all that you do every day in our lives. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you freely and to share the goodness of your Son, Jesus Christ. You sent your Son, knowing that it was your plan that he would die for our sins. We have been caught up in circumstances this week that fall short of our worthiness to receive your loving grace for these shortcomings. In the quietness of these moments, we come to you with humble hearts to make our personal confessions. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Wow, what a pretty morning, huh? A little bit chilly. Makes you think that the snow is coming and Halloween is coming close by, huh? Sometimes when we think of Halloween, we get a little fearful because there are goblins and ghosts around, but we know they're not real. God's there to protect us. And you know what else happens sometimes? On Sunday mornings, we come and we're really good. Did you ever do anything bad in church? Probably not. We all try to be really good while we're here, right? And Sunday especially, we try to be good, right? But sometimes people forget during the week, so they're not quite so good on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Then they get real good again on Sunday. But you know what? They think God's not noticing, but God notices. That's okay if he sits up here. You want him to sit down there. Oh, that's okay. But anyway, they think that God's not noticing when they're not so good on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. But you know what? God knows everything we're doing all time, even in the middle of the night when we have to get up and go to the bathroom sometimes like I do. But anyway, I have a song I want you to learn. Years ago, I had some kids learn it because I learned it when I was a little kid. So are you listening real closely here? This is the way it goes. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. Can you say that with me? Sing it with me. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. That's the way it begins. Some of you may know this from when you were little, but you were already little. Okay, so it goes like this. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. I went to the rocks to hide my face. The rocks cried out, no hiding place. Wouldn't you think you could hide among the rocks? God wouldn't see you among the rocks, would he? But you know, even among the rocks, God can see us. So I want you to sing the whole song with me. Ready? Are you ready to sing? Isabel, you ready to sing too? Oh, there's no hiding place down here. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. I went to the rocks to hide my face. The rocks cried out, no hiding place down here. Okay, now I want you to stand up. And when we say, when I go to the rocks to hide my face, we're going to crouch down. And then when the rocks cry out, no hiding place, we're going to jump up. No hiding place. Okay, are you ready? Okay, everybody stand up. Are you ready? Okay. Harder for some of us to stand up than others. Okay, are you ready? Sing real loud. Ready? Oh, there's no hiding place down here. Oh, there's no hiding place down here. I went to the rocks to hide my face. The rocks cried out,
no hiding place.
No hiding place down here. Oh, thank you so much. Now, sometimes that's a little scary to think God's watching us all the time, because he knows when we're doing good and when we're doing bad. But thank goodness he knows when we're doing good, because I have something in the scripture I want to read to you just a minute. Okay. It says that God has his eye on us. He knows every hair in our head. Think of all the hairs you got in your head. And God knows about every one of those hairs. So he really knows about us. In fact, he has his eye on the sparrows. And not one of them can fall to the ground that he does not know about. So I'm thinking, if God even has his eyes on the sparrows, he has his eyes on you and you and you and you, 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 all of you out there. He has his eyes on all of us and cares for all of us. And I want to end this with my favorite song before we, I'm not going to sing a whole song, I'm just going to sing the very end of it, okay? His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. And then the other ending is, I know he cares for me. So I want you to keep that in mind as you go through the week. Know that God watches us every moment, but also that he cares for us. Will you bow your heads down with me and pray? Dear God, we thank you so much for our many blessings. We know that you watch over us, and we know that you care for us. Amen.
Again, welcome to all who are worshiping this day at First Presbyterian Church. We hope that you feel the love and the presence of God as we sit in this beautiful, beautiful house of worship. For those who are visiting this morning, there are welcome packets in the back of the church, and we encourage you to take one when you leave the sanctuary. At the end of the pews, the friendship registers. You kind of know what to do. Please fill them out, pass them down the row, and then pass them back so you can see who you're sitting next to. Thanks for your help in this area. Following today's service, there will be refreshments in the social hall. We encourage you to stay and enjoy in the fellowship with the congregation. Now, I'm putting a challenge out there, and this is for me too. Go to another table today and maybe visit with somebody else. I know some of us sit together every week, and I love it. But sometimes, you know, you got to get out of your comfort zone and just maybe visit somebody else this morning. It's fall and the programs at church here are in full swing. Youth programs are on Wednesday evening, Logos at 5 o'clock, Jam for the junior highs at 5:30, and the senior highs meet at 7 o'clock. Pastor John's Bible study is also on Wednesday, but it's 10:30 in the morning. There's Sunday school classes on Sundays at 9:30 for everybody, all grade levels and adults too. There will be a meeting on Wednesday, November the 2nd, at South School for anyone who is interested in tutoring at South School. This is an hour out of your time to help some of the kids there at South School who need just a little more help brushing up. I don't know if they're doing math or reading this year. Mostly reading this year. So if you're interested, please contact Dynamic and find out some more about the idea. If you remember, we did the devotional booklets this summer for Growth for God. There's going to be an Advent devotional book that's going to be created similar to that devotional book. There are forms in the narthex, or you can either do a handwritten copy on that or email your devotional into the church office. The Mission Committee is sponsoring a Christmas bazaar the first three Sundays of the month of December after church in the social hall. I think this kind of follows the idea to the Presby Market, but the proceeds from this will go to the EPC World Outreach Mission to help with the flood victims in Louisiana. In your bulletins, and I didn't bring it up with me, there are a couple inserts. One is for the spaghetti supper. I believe it's on the 9th of November. Six. Thank you. And please sign up and just put them in the offering boxes if you're interested in staying after church for this. And this is more or less a free will offering dinner. It's nothing you have to bring. There are other announcements to read in the bulletins at your leisure. Would you please prepare your hearts for prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and the opportunity to worship with you. We thank you for the beauty that surrounds us in this fall season. Only you could be so awesome to create such beauty to make our lives just a little richer. We know that you love us so much. Your proof of this incredible love was to give up your Son, Jesus Christ, to live among us, to die for our sins, and then to rise from the dead, all in love. We pray, Lord, for this church, this session as it oversees the work of the church, the deacons as they reach out to the needs of our community. Be with the vision team as they work on a 3 to 5 year strategic plan for our church. Be with the staff of the church and Pastor John as he ministers to this congregation. Be with the youth programs of our church. Help them to grow in the ways of Jesus. We pray for the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. Look out for the safety and the well-being of the missionaries that we support, the Castelluccios and the Holcombs. Also be with Sam and Kristen and their family, the EPC's cross-cultural workers, as they spread the word of your Son, Jesus, to others in the world who might not know and love him. We pray for all of the people who have not yet accepted Jesus into their lives. Lord, we pray for the nation and the world. Be with the elected officials that they may make wise choices for the people. Be with the hungry, the poor, and those who have health issues. We know that your care is there for all of us and your comfort and your strength. We pray for Tony Walters as he recovers from eye surgery this past week. Be with Max Fugger as he is, and give him comfort and just rest as he is approaching maybe possibly end-of-life situations. Be with Paulette Shields. She just needs to be lifted up and to be in our prayers. We pray for those listed in the bulletin or are nameless among our friends and family. that need your love and your power for healing. Lord, bless us all and give us peace in our hearts. We pray all of these things in the name of the risen Lord, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'd like to invite Matt Hounshell to come up. He's back at the camera for the first reading of our scripture.
Matthew 25, verses 14 through 18. Hear the word of the Lord. The parable of the talents. For it is as if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them, and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks.
We invite you to take your pew Bible, if you will, and turn to Matthew 25. We're going to read the end of that particular passage, beginning at verse 19. It's on 28 in the New Testament section of your Bible. And I invite you to stand, Matthew 25, 19 to 30, and I will begin reading. Let us hear the word of the Lord. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master."
And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you made a good steward over many talents. See, I have made 2 more talents.
His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master."
Then the one who had received 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed.
So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours."
But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew what you did too, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter.
Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest." For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Let's just bow our hearts in prayer together. Our loving and gracious God, we thank you for your word, its truth, and we thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit that applies that truth to our lives, that allows it to spring up into something that is alive and challenging, that draws us and brings us closer to you. And so today, Lord, we ask for that to take place in each one of our lives. Use this word to teach us and to bring us closer to you. For we pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today is Talent Sunday, and it's a time to stop for a moment, to reflect upon what God has done in and through our lives through the course of this summer. As you may remember, $20 was given to the church family, each individual family, if you chose to take it, to be used and to be multiplied for something that we would jointly agree on. And let's face it, it isn't often that we are giving out money. Thanks be to Lilly Endowment for providing those resources. But I think it's important as we talk about this time of celebration, of what God has done through us, as we look at that time, it was actually May 22nd when that money was handed out. It's kind of an experiment, if you will, to illustrate the truth of this parable. It's important for us to understand the context of this particular parable as we think about its meaning. And so, if you have your pew Bibles, I encourage you to open up to Matthew 25 on page 28 and actually flip it over, if you will, to page 27, Matthew 24, because the context out of which this parable comes is in the context of Christ's second coming. And that's an important thing for us to understand and realize. In verse 30, if you want to look at that for a moment, Jesus says, "Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." And you think, why is everybody going to be crying and mourning? Well, it's because they've been proven wrong. Because Christ, in all of his glory, is, in fact, coming back. Then verse 31, "And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." The second coming, a great day. But look down to verse 36. "But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father." In other words, only God the Father is aware of that time. We don't know the day, the hour, the season, the year. We don't know when that is coming, but it is something we're looking forward to. So having said that, how are we to use this interim period of time? All of us within the church, Christians, how are we to use this period of time? And flip over to the next page on page 28, verse 42 there in the top left. And it says, "Keep awake, therefore," and some of your versions, if you're using your own Bible, may, say something similar to that. "But keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming." Keep awake. Keep watch. Now, he's not saying here, take a no-dose so you don't fall asleep or have a few more cups of coffee. He's not saying that. He's not saying, take your binoculars and go up to a mountain and start looking. That's kind of a waste of time. But what he is saying is this: I'm giving you some important stories, some parables, that will help you understand how to use this time that we have. And one of those stories is the parable of the talents in Matthew 25, 14 through 30. As we've heard that story read for us, we need to kind of keep in mind these things. First of all, the master is going on a long journey. Just as Jesus Christ, after his death and resurrection, went on a long journey. He went to heaven. But secondly, this master, in preparation for that journey, gives out talents, allotments of money. And in this case, it was a lot of money to be used, developed, invested, multiplied, so that when the master came back, they could see all that God had done through them to help multiply the master's treasure. And Jesus Christ, in preparing to go to heaven, said, "It's better that I go, because you know who I'm going to send to you? The Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit fills us when we become a Christian, gives out spiritual gifts, talents, to be used for the furtherance of God's work, to build his kingdom." So the question is, how are we using those talents? What are we doing with them? We know that the Holy Spirit of Christ has given out those talents. Some of you are teachers. You love to work with little kids, adolescents, older adults. You can bring the message of Christ to bear upon their lives. Some of you are great organizers. And we saw some of that this past summer during the sabbatical. You help to organize things, whether it be a retreat or whether it be an event of some kind. Others of you have leadership. You have a vision for where God wants us to go. And you're utilizing that on our various boards, on committees. Others of you have a really big heart. And when someone is sick or going through a difficulty, it's your natural inclination to write a note or to pick up the phone or to go and talk with them. You have a big heart. That's the gift of compassion. You know, there's some here today who have the gift of just sharing what God has done in your life. And people listen because they hear in that a ring of authenticity and genuineness. You have the gift of evangelism. You see, there are so many gifts. The gift of music that rings true, a message that touches our heart. I mean, the list goes on and on. And so those gifts are given. And they are given in such a way to be used, to enrich the lives of others, to enrich the church, to build it up, and most importantly, to shed light on Jesus Christ so that other people might know him. You know, there's a story that comes out of Great Britain during World War II that to me is a fantastic story. Winston Churchill realized that in order to accomplish the war effort, there needed to be more silver to be used. And they found that their resources were depleting. And so he had people out and about looking. People realized that they had silver in their homes that could add to that effort. But more so, within the churches and the cathedrals throughout Great Britain, there were sterling silver statues of saints that could be used. And Churchill said, "It is now time to come and to put the saints into circulation. Rather than have them on a pedestal or in a corner, put those saints into circulation." And friends, that's the heart of the meaning of the parable of the talents. It's time to put the saints into circulation, to utilize those gifts and abilities to deepen the work of Christ. And so today we're here to celebrate. Celebrate what you have done with that $20. Now, some of you might say, "Well, Pastor, I left it at home or I forgot all about it. We didn't get that phone tree message. I'm sorry." Well, you know, I understand that. But maybe there's a story you still have to share about how you use that $20. I've gotten a few notes here that I want to share as well. But I know that there are others of you that have something to share about how God used your creativity, your ingenuity to take that $20 and to multiply it into something far greater. And you know, we decided as a congregation that that $20 was going to be used along with everything else as a mission. It's going for Big Brothers, Big Sisters. It's going for Fish here in Dark County and Youth for Christ. So everything that we have done through this experiment is going to further the work of the kingdom. And if I can get this microphone to turn on, there we go. I just want people to have an opportunity to share. And I did ask Tina, and where is Tina? Hey, is this on, Dan? Is it on?
There we go. Boy, we know that it's on.
Tina, hey, would you just stand up?
Would you just share what you did with your $20 and what you learned through the whole process?
Okay. Well, first of all, I just want to say awesome job to everyone that participated. It's amazing what we can do as we work as a team to do God's work. But I don't really have anything that's profound to say, like some of you, I'm sure. But what I did was I just made pies, and I made caramel corn, and I sold them at the Presby Market, and I ended up with $92. And I do have a story, though, to tell. Nancy Jackson, a lot of you know Nancy, she asked me if I'd make her a lemon pie and a butterscotch pie. So I called Nancy to ask her how the pie was, and she said it was very good, and she said that she had gotten me some new customers. So Nancy thought that I was going to start selling pies. But I explained to her that I wasn't, you know, selling pies. I was just doing it to raise money for the talents that we were, for the project that we were doing at church. So, but I guess what I learned from all this is that when we all work together as a church family, we can accomplish a lot. So.
Hey, great. Great. Yeah, you could go online and start a business, too, after this. Tina's Pies, hey. Anybody else? Karen.
Stand up and turn around.
Okay. Well, Tina mentioned Nancy Jackson, who's not a member of our church, but is involved in what we do in this church. And she knitted and sold her knitting, and in this envelope is $110. From what she has sold to give to our church. And like Tina, I made pies. And, you know, because when they gave me the 20 bucks, I'm going, what can I do? I don't have any great, wonderful ideas. You know, they had ideas, you know, for face painting and doing different things. And I'm going, I don't have that. And we talked in a meeting for when we did the hymn sing, and started discussing, and Helen mentioned, she said, I wish we could do a bake sale. And I said, oh, that sounds good. And that's what we decided to do, is like they have the market up on Broadway, to have the same type of thing here, the Presby Market. People could bring their baked goods or all their other things that they make. It wasn't just food, but it was vegetables, and it was books that had been made, and just all kinds of really neat, talented things, and we hope to do that again in December.
Hey, thank you. Anybody else? Jocelyn.
Well, I knew that I couldn't grow anything, as a lot of the people did, and I'm not that good of a baker. So I thought about it, and I thought I'd quilt, and I sew. So I decided to dig around in my stash, as we call it as quilters, found some things there that I could use, and went out and purchased some other things. I did make some children's books, soft books we call them, or cloth books, and I made some candle mats, and also had a wall hanging that had the psalm, quotes from the psalms in it. And so those were the things that I offered just at one Presby Market, pretty much sold out the first time. So, but it challenged me to get busy. I hadn't been doing a lot of quilting for a while, and it, you know, got the old sewing machine out, and just felt like I was doing something to help other people.
Phyllis, I'm gonna squeeze in here, or actually I'll just hand it down to you.
First, I just wanna thank God for giving me some talents. I crochet, I quilt, and I do a lot of other things. But anyway, one morning before Carl passed away, I was having a very hard time. I went down in the lobby and I was doing a baby Afghan. One of the supervisors came over and gave me a hug, and she asked me what I was crocheting, and I said, I'm crocheting a baby Afghan. And she said, when you're done with that, would you sell it? So I sold it for $60. And then I have another little, I don't know whether you would call this talents or not, but I had a lot of help. I had two tires on our car that had to have attention 7 times. And God was really testing me. And I know I shouldn't mention this person's name, but it's Karen's son and Tina's husband. Came on a Sunday, and he thought he had it fixed. And he left, and I got up Monday morning, and the tire was down again. I called Tina, and I said, this tire is low again. So Kirk came back that afternoon, and he found a hole in it. I asked him what I owed him, and he said, you just give whatever you want to the church, which I thought was a blessing. So I have $130.
All right.
Hey, I know Leroy shared his talent because I bought one of those loaves. But I'll let you, Leroy, have a chance to share a little bit about what you did.
Okay, well, I had to write some of this down so I wouldn't forget what I wanted to say. When we were given the envelope with the $20 in it and instructions to read the parable, the talents, I think, what in the world can I do? That would be, I don't have any talents. And it finally dawned on me that the talent I had actually started with would bake banana bread for Henny. He loved it. And I don't know how many loaves I made for him, probably a dozen, I don't know. But it seemed like that must be what my talent is, you know, making banana nut bread. So I continually would make them for my family and my friends. And so I thought, why not? I'll be the banana nut bread guy. And to sell them and to multiply the $20 that was given me to start with. So I made a total of 13 loaves for this project, and I have $130 to give to the church.
I'm hearing well done and good and faithful servant. Hey, anybody else? Gina. Well, it just kind of helps, you know. Here you go.
It doesn't really matter, does it? Well, my talent was my mom gave me a round loom set to make adult hats and baby hats and booties. So that's what I used my parable talent for. It was my husband's idea, so he's been helping me do that. And so I've actually done my snow cone machine over at the fairgrounds, and I have $40 to give to the church.
All right. Hey, Jane, I know you and Kelsey have something to share.
When we were given the opportunity to grow the talents, I can see a lot of talents in this girl, but she doesn't often see what she could be doing. So we did a joint effort, and the thing that I love about what we did was that we got to do it together, and we came up with creative things. The part that I don't like is that we could have done far more, but the good part is it's still ongoing, and I'll let her tell a little bit more about what she did.
Okay, so through what the Gilmores offered to me, I took furniture and repurposed it, old vases and all these other things that I just kind of gave new life to and everything, and I took the stuff that we had made, and with the help of my mom and dad and Brandon here, we took it to the gathering at the Garst, and we did a huge like little vendor sale. And like my mom said, it's still ongoing, and I'm still selling those things, what I have left over at school and everything. So we just have $200 to give to the church.
Wow. And I think we need to congratulate Kelsey and Brandon. They are engaged to be married now. Yes. Anybody else would like to share? All right.
Webb. I'd like to share the talent that I was given. And it really took my wife to bring that to fruition. I offered organization and encouragement to her to cook and bake. She was a little nervous being new here, and I knew personally that she was a good cook. So I encouraged her to make several different baked goods, and one that I really liked and that I actually partook in was the blueberry and lemon pound cake. So it turned out real good, and Jane's happy. She's still in the process of working with her talent, and we don't have a final amount, but we're getting close.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Well, wonderful.
Tina's vouching that they were awesome.
Linda.
Now, I know you all know that we're relatively new to the area, and I don't have any real particular talent. I rely on my husband, but he needs encouragement. And so, like others, I encouraged him to help and move some of the things that we were leaving behind in Tennessee that we no longer needed or had room for here. And so I encouraged him again to strongly bring those things back here in one of his many visits to Tennessee. And we put those up for auction, and I have the money here to give to the church.
Ah, wonderful. Well, terrific.
Thanks for bringing those things back, Ken. We appreciate that. Anyone else? Oh, Helen. Okay. All right.
The lemon blueberry is awesome. I couldn't have one of her. She had these chocolate pies that were just, and it was like, no, I can't eat that whole thing myself. Anyway, so I made friendship bread and did that, and I thought, that takes a while to get going. And then I made homemade noodles. I am not taking orders for Thanksgiving. Anyway, between the friendship bread and the homemade noodles, I have $105 to get.
Things are just multiplying. Hey, I have a feeling we could go on and on here, but I'm going to have Jan and maybe Beth kind of finish this up, and later we can hear more stories.
Beth and I thought we were really doing good with $140, but we decided that we'd buy face paints and paint on Broadway, so we painted in front of Second National Bank three different First Friday nights, and we loved it. We made a little jar that said Community Missions. The wonderful thing was that as people put their money in, or kids put their money, we got dimes even, but one lady even put in a 20. Several people said, what a wonderful idea. Our church should do that. Or, oh, that is a great mission idea. And so we got, between us, $140, and no more than that. Well, yeah, $140 plus our $20, and anything you want to say? No, I mean, it was so much fun too. And we painted lots of dolphins and ballerinas and unicorns. Anyway, it was so much fun. As you know, oh, I wanted to put a little agenda or a little PS on this. It was great fun, much like children's sermons. You do not realize how much fun it is to do children's sermons and watch the kids' expression and their little comments that none of you ever hear. So more of you should volunteer for children's sermons.
Well, that's a good segue. In your bulletin today, there's a talent sign up. And we've done this periodically the last month or so. You've probably noticed many of you have signed. But we thought, you know, on this Sunday particularly, it's an opportunity, if you haven't signed up for something where you'd like to share your gift, your talent, ability, please do so. Because we are distributing those things out to the various committees. so that people can be put to work. You know, the thing is, it's not work, it's a ministry. And it's not an experiment for one time, it's a lifestyle of serving. And that's really what the parable of the talents is all about. Because this is what we're to do until when? Christ returns. Christ comes. So I just have a couple more things. It says the Amex purchased herb plants and sold herbs and dishes made with those herbs. And we want to thank them for utilizing their gifts. And then this is from Ginny Bertram. She's back with the kids. I'm returning $164.22 from my original 20. Tina helped me by buying two of my doll outfits, and my other regulars bought my chocolate-covered strawberries and the lettuce, bean, and tomatoes from my garden. The congregation was very generous when they donated for my veggies. Thanks to all of you, Ginny Bertram. And then Marnelise Vanderwalt did planters with flowers, and she just writes this prayer, Heavenly Father, who blesses us with your love and bounty, thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ who supported this ministry that we might share in your work through the missions of our congregation. Bless its use to meet the needs of those who have use for it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you know, the truth is, we are saints and we need to be put into circulation. Let's say that. We are saints to be put into circulation. I'm going to ask Terry if she might just play some background music. And before we have our prayer, if you have an envelope that you'd like to bring forward and place in one of the offering plates up front for this mission, please feel free to do that. Maybe you weren't here on stewardship or on the Sunday that we handed out the 20 and you'd just like to add to it. You feel free to do that. But let's just rejoice and celebrate for what God has done through you, this congregation, the saints. Let me tell you, you've been in circulation.
Sacrifice of praise to the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. The sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
Many great things are prepared there for you. Enjoy the fellowship. Share the love of Christ. And now go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing that his Spirit goes with you. And may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance and give you his peace, both now and in the life to come and forever. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We hope you've enjoyed another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church in downtown Greenville. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to invite you to come to our Sunday School Hour, which begins Sundays at 9:30, with morning worship to follow at 10:30. We're located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached at 937-548-3188. And if you're looking on the web, we're at www.greenvillepres.org. Throughout the week, we've got several ministries, small groups, Bible studies, along with youth and children's ministries on Wednesday afternoon and into the evening. There's something for everyone. And we do hope that you might consider First Presbyterian. We would love to have you part of our worshiping community, whether it be in person or on our telecast Wednesday evenings. But until next time, may God's word dwell richly in your life. Goodbye from First Presbyterian.